Hello, my fellow mods, and welcome to The Perspective. I'm your host, John O'Neill, and in association with DC Hillier and MCM Daily, the holiday season is coming up. And we've just spoken to an entrepreneur about the gift that his grandfather has bestowed upon him, an iconic Christmas tree design, which he has brought back to life and made available for our community. It has been photographed in many historic modernist homes, and this journey has brought him to connect with many members of our community and a memorable experience on Shark Tank. I'm not sure if we deconstructed the history of Christmas more than his grandfather deconstructed the Christmas tree, but we welcome you into this story of perseverance and thick, tattooed skin with Matt Bliss, owner of Modern Christmas Trees.
Hey, there he is.
Am I too light, do you think? I can swap out this light bulb for a doctor one, I think.
I think you're good.
I think it looks okay. Looks natural.
You don't have a Christmas tree right next to you, so it can project all the light all over the place.
I'm sorry, guys.
We're not quite to the season, but we're almost there.
Some people are already, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, man, I used to work in retail, and come like October 1st.
People can't wait for it. Yeah.
You got the Christmas, like nobody even cares about Halloween or any spooky music. The Christmas music is starting, all is jolly.
Yeah, right.
But no, Matt, I assume that you'd like that to be the case the whole year.
Yeah, can we just get rid of Halloween altogether?
Let's get rid of Halloween. No Thanksgiving, you know, 4th of July.
Can we do Christmas twice?
Yeah.
Yeah,
I'm down.
Like one in July, and
I like that.
Yeah, man, the seasonal business, it's you got one shot each year to get it right.
Yeah.
If you don't get it right, then you got to wait another year to try and correct your mistakes and get it right. It's very difficult.
And busy. I can only imagine.
Yeah, no, come on.
It's like, guys, couldn't you have, you know, planned a little bit ahead of time when you wanted to get a tree?
That's the thing. We're trying to encourage people to plan ahead. And part of our new strategy this year is, and we'll get into all this, is we no longer run sales. I hired a business consultant because I've determined that I'm not a great business person yet.
I'm sure that's not the case, but
no,
reinforcements help.
Yeah. I mean, you have to focus on what you're good at and get help on the aspects of the business that you're not. And I think a lot of business people would say that, at least this is my case, that I'm just too in the weeds with it to be able to think like a consumer would. And so, we're not running sales anymore. And it's more on brand. Tesla and Tiffany and even Whole Foods and a lot of luxury brands don't run sales. It's just, either it's worth the price to you and you understand it, or it's not. And offering 25% off isn't gonna do anything to you. And a lot of times with sales too, it's like, you know, you run a sale and you say, all right, 50% off. What you're telling the consumer is it's not worth the full price.
Well, and never, so, you know, I don't want half price sushi, and I never want half price tattoos. And I want to see your tattoo of this tree, to be totally honest. It's beautiful.
I'll show it to you, but that reminded me, in Las Vegas, they have billboards that say half price attorneys.
Yeah, you don't want that either.
I would add that to the list, but I don't think I want a half price attorney
good.
For this DUI.
I'm good. I mean, occasionally too, I see the Herman Miller and Knoll sales. If I'm a consumer, so I agree with you fully, and I've thought about this before in a lot of different ways, and I'll give you an example. If I'm a consumer and I'm in the market for a Herman, you know, $5,000, $6,000 Herman Miller Eames chair, I'm waiting for that 15% off, right? And then that affects, you know, the behavior. And you also have seasonality going. You got a couple other things going, different variables. And so I would certainly agree that, you know, sales aren't the way to go, and they're worth it. They're beautiful. I mean,
thank you.
They are definitely worth it. And I can say one thing for sure. there's never a sale on a Claritone. That's true. Are going to spend the money that we're asking or you're not getting one. That's just the way it is. But that's the thing. It is a prestige item. And the tree, a Christmas tree, I was looking it up. And you can buy traditional artificial trees that are fully decked out with built-in LED lighting and all that stuff. And they can go for as high as $3,000. But you get a tree that looks very nice, but it's a traditional tree. Right. So if you look at an 8-foot tree that's modern, a unique design,
art,
and very customizable, it's art. Yeah. And also what I like about modern Christmas trees, if I may, when I was writing the book, I had to describe what my obsession was. They didn't end up using it, but why I'm obsessed with collecting lamps and lighting and stuff like that. Or why I like lamps so much anyway. And what I like about lamps is that they exist in two worlds. A lamp is corporeal. It's an object. It sits there. And when you turn it on, it's ephemeral. That the shadows that it casts are temporary until you turn the light off again.
Sure.
And then it's back to its corporeal form. Now, they thought that was a little too heady for the books or whatever. That's what I like about the tree is that it has such a presence in the ephemeral world. It's cast its existence, if you will, throughout the ceiling, the walls, everywhere.
Yeah.
And it's a huge thing. It's not just sitting in the corner looking pretty and sparkly, but it occupies the entire space.
Hearing that from you means a lot to me. There's this thing, and I think, and maybe it's my own insecurity as a person, but I think a lot of artists or musicians, you know, you write a new song and, you know, you perform it for the first time and you're like, God, man, you know, I hope people like this. and I guess a true artist doesn't really care. And they're like, oh, fuck them.
They care. They care just a little bit. I mean, let's be honest.
As a law school graduate, I know a lot of working artists, a lot, musicians as well, and they all care.
Yeah.
Trust me.
Oh, yeah.
They do not live in these light-sided bubbles. They care. And it's important to them. It's important to have that feedback because art is a solitary, whether you're designing a beautiful object or creating a beautiful painting or sculpture, whatever. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's an insular solitary pursuit in most cases.
Yeah.
And like anything in the art world, whether it's film even, that everybody becomes a valid critic of what you've just created. Even if they don't have a background in that. So Matt, you design and refined your grandfather's tree. That's double the burden. You have to
get
assurances that you're doing the right thing.
Caretaker, also, direction.
And you're also, you're the steward of your grandfather's design. So yeah, I can see an added burden to that for sure.
No, there absolutely is because, you know, at some level, if somebody said, and you know, I get this feedback every once in a while, you know, when you put yourself out there, you are open to criticism. And, you know, if it was just me, it would be like, eh, whatever, fuck you, you know, but it's my grandfather.
There's a little added passion.
Yeah,
sure.
So it's like, you know, we did a trade show, the Denver Modernism Show. Where I got my start 10 years ago, which was a couple weeks ago.
10 years, everybody. It takes a while. You got to grind.
It's funny you say that because, you know, there's that, if you're familiar with Seth Godin, you know, the Purple Cow.
Yeah.
You know, it was refreshing to hear him say, I'm reading or listening to This Is Marketing. And
beautiful.
You know, it talks about like finding the smallest viable market and pursuing that market for many, many years. Like the idea of anything being an overnight success, it's unrealistic. I've had to kind of redefine what success is with all of this. Like, you know, it's not about being a multimillionaire. It's about being able to create things that didn't exist before I touched them and then share that. So yeah, it's been, I'm going to write a book called Entre-manure.
I like that.
All of the mistakes that have been made. And
of
you know, the thing that frustrates me about a lot of entrepreneurs, like you'll ask, you know, how things are going. It's like, oh my God, so great. It's just blowing up. And I just think to myself, like, A, I don't believe you. And B, you know, talk to me, you know, shit isn't easy.
Yeah. I'm the type that wants to hear about the scar tissue. That makes me tick, you know, and like you were just talking about the trade shows. I mean, 10 years, I'm sure, showing up at Denver Modernism Week and Modernism Week in Palm Springs and a lot of other trade shows, but likely relevant to hospitality as well as, you know, retail. It's a grind. And you got to put in the time. And I would say I'm starting to feel a similar sense of passion. You've been at it far longer. But the fact that we're sitting down at night after our day jobs, editing this, learning what works, iterating, you know, I'm sure you've gone through that.
I will tell you this. I've done a bunch of these, and this is the best looking group that I have ever done this with.
Well, DC's background takes it away. I mean, look at those lamps. Look at that grapefruit tree that he grew from seed, right, DC?
Yeah, love it.
Yeah.
Look, this is a lot of fun, and I think we're doing it because we want to have cool conversations and really, really dig in and learn. I think, honestly, DC, you mentioned, you know, a little bit of the backstory here. Matt, why don't you give us a little insight into that moment that you rediscovered your grandfather's tree, right? Yeah. It sounds like during a move. And then it dawned on you that, you know, this is something viable here.
Yeah, I mean, this was the tree that we grew up with. My grandfather only made a few trees throughout his lifetime.
Sure. Yeah, it wasn't a product for sale.
No, it was never a product. It was never taken to the market. It was just something that he was an engineer. He did projects for NASA, actually.
Very cool. You
know, and he helped design the liquid nitrogen tanks on all the Apollo missions.
Wow.
So, you know, if you couple that with later in his career, he spent decades building A-frame cabins throughout the Rocky Mountains. So
very cool.
You could kind of understand how he would come up with something like this.
Yeah.
And, you know, as an engineer, he loved, triangle.
A lot of angles going on.
right. And I tried to learn as much about it. The catalyst for doing this was when he was diagnosed with Alzheimer's.
Sure.
That was just brutal for me. And the last years of his life, you know, after my grandma had passed away, were just not good years for him.
Sure.
And, you know, I was like, man, you know, what can I do for this guy? You know,
I
get to talk about him, you know, his signature is engraved on every tree that I make. I don't think he wouldn't have cared about any of that. There is no doubt, though, that he would be shocked at the fact that this is resonating with anyone.
Yeah.
Because that's not something that he cared about.
Sure.
One of the stories that my uncle tells me is that, so he built A-frame cabins throughout the Rocky Mountains, which is another seasonal business, which is interesting.
Yeah, sure.
Being in Denver.
Yeah.
And all of his, he had four sons and a daughter. My mom was the oldest. All summer, they all worked 60, 70 hours a week.
Yeah, I'm sure.
And they were at a diner somewhere in Summit County, 5:30 in the morning. And my uncle brought in a newspaper. And in the business section, it was, you know, a picture of him and his A-frames. And it was a big story about him and his A-frames.
Wow.
And my uncle, like, jumped out of his chair and thought it was the greatest thing ever. And my grandfather, his response was, well, I hope it sells a few more cabins.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it wasn't like he wasn't doing this out of, you know, vanity or look what I can do. It was just, you know, what do I got to do to send my kids through college and
get the word out.
So, to go back to your question about how I, you know, rediscovered it. You know, it was up in their home every Christmas Eve since I can possibly remember. And then as they got older, there was a time where they were no longer hosting Christmas Eve.
Sure.
And so I helped them move into a retirement community. And I saw this tree on the shelf in the garage. And I asked if I could have it. And I think he was surprised that I had any interest in it.
Wow.
And I took it home and I put it up. And I think I left it up for 3 years or something.
cool.
And... partly out of laziness. Yeah. And so, I mean, from there, I kind of would look at it every day and, you know, I had a girlfriend at the time that thought it was really interesting. And she actually, you know, posted a couple photos on social media and he was still in good health. My grandma was still alive at the time.
Yeah.
And so, you know, there wasn't the interest in doing that. Although I have always been a a big fan of design. And at the time I lived in a mid-century modern home, and
beautiful.
It's just interesting how it all kind of, you know, this has been a gift, really.
It worked. Yeah.
I'm having to kind of see it as that it's this, you know, take the pressure off yourself. This is a gift that your grandfather has given you. And
yeah. He
doesn't care how much money it makes or how many trees have sold.
Sure.
You know, I think he's probably, you know, looking down, well, shaking his head, and there's no way he would, I don't know what he would say. He would be speechless, I'm sure. So yeah, it kind of started from there. It took two trees to the Denver Modernism Show almost exactly 10 years ago and displayed them just to kind of figure out if I had anything here. Did I love it because my grandfather made it, or did I love it because it was, you know, good design? I was too shy to even really work the booth initially. I kind of stopped the trees, and then I kind of walked away and, you know, kind of listened in to see what people's reaction.
You open the newspaper and you know, kind of walk on by.
Yeah, right.
What's everybody think? What are they saying? That's great.
Yeah, I mean, it started there, and, you know, sold a bunch of trees at that show and did it part-time. And then things just started to come together, and every year was a little bit better than the previous. And
Sure.
You know, the I think the thing that gave me the confidence to see it as maybe a viable business is when Disney reached out to me to do a bunch of custom trees for their Disneyland hotel in Anaheim.
Got it. Yeah, I wanted to ask. Those are the upside down.
Yeah, right. The upside down ones. And that was a neat thing because my grandfather passed away in 2011 at the end of October, and a week later I got a patent on his design. And then 2 weeks later, there were 14 of these custom trees that I made at the Disneyland Hotel in Anaheim. And half my family lives in Southern California.
Wow. What a
month. You know, we buried him. And then 2 weeks later, they all went down and, you know, looked at all his work at the Disneyland Hotel. It was just like, is this real? Is this happening? Yeah. I still have never seen it. It's part of their, you know, annual festivities. And, I guess it's kind of a cool attraction.
Absolutely. And really, look, we operate in a niche, all of us. I mean, in many ways, a very passionate and engaged niche, which is why I think, you know, just like Seth Godin says, I think that's where you start, because, you know, you want to get people excited and get that energy going, and then that energy becomes contagious. But what a way to sort of start, you know, with that kind of very native, you know, building who can put that front and center.
Yeah.
And then, you know, hopefully have that, get people to ask some questions about where you can get that. You know, then it seems like it's taken you to a number of different mid-century modern houses for, you know, photo shoots. Some of the most famous. I mean, Stallhouse on my list.
Stallhouse is probably one of the better, not better, they're all great. Certainly one of the more beautiful ones, but obviously I think the Farnsworth house, they're just amazing, those photos.
Yeah.
I have to say that J.C. Buck, that your photographer, is a great photographer.
I appreciate you bringing it up because I have it on my notes to reference him, but he quit his job about the time that I quit my job to do it full time. So he didn't even really have a background in photography. So to go from, I mean, those shots from the Stallhouse were, I mean, he was like 3 years in, 2 years in of being a professional photographer.
Yeah.
And it's been, we've become like best friends, and it's just, that's the other thing about this that I see is it being a gift, is I get the opportunity now to work with some amazingly talented people that, some of which were my friends before, but I had no excuse being in the mortgage business to work with any of these people. Like,
unless you wanted to be annoying, right? You guys want to refinance? Yeah.
I appreciate you saying that. The experiences of shooting the tree in those houses with him, it's been a more important piece to this journey than even Shark Tank was for me, because the feedback or the advice that I got from somebody that I looked up to initially when I started this was, you know, really spend time and money photographing the tree as best you possibly can.
Yep.
And so
it's quality over quantity for sure.
Yeah. Right. And so based on that, I was like, all right, well, what's the perfect venue then to display this tree? And I reached out to I've known DC for a while now. He's, you know, been a good supporter of what I do, and picked his brain and started doing more research about what houses are conducive to this tree and can really showcase it. Like the stall house, I mean, it's a mirrored box and the tree goes right there. You know, there was no like, where are we going to put the tree? It's like, no, the tree goes in one place and nowhere
it's
else.
That spot, that iconic spot.
Right. And each of these photo shoots have their own unique stories. And to be able to share that with some of these people, it's just, you know, the model in some of the particularly the Farnsworth house photos was a girl I went to high school with, one of my best friends.
Do you remember on that shoot, Matt, that were her shoes too big?
DC, were you there?
No.
Okay. Yeah. You just noticed that? That's great.
That photo.
That's great.
And yeah. I remember I'm going to make it the MCM Daily Facebook's page headline, like the banner page.
Right on.
And it's a great holiday thing.
Yeah.
And I remember I said, I'm going to have to crop this. And I hate having to crop professional photographers' work because it's such, it's very presumptive to go in and change. Yeah, but I wanted to make it more linear. But as I just happened, I remember I magnified the image on Photoshop and it just zoomed up really quickly with the mouse pad. And I'm going, her shoes are like an inch too long for her feet. I did something even more presumptuous, excuse me. So I fixed it. I moved the heel of the shoe.
I'm totally fine with that. And I think JC would be okay with that too.
That's great.
The other one that's interesting is there is a photo of me sitting in an Eames chair at the stall house.
Wow. I mean, what's better than that?
Yeah, no, I know. But it was so funny because JC's like, you know what? We need some life in this. Go ahead and sit in that chair. And so I sat down and I looked down at my socks and I have one white sock on and one black sock on. So, yeah, these little things with these photo shoots.
Those are what you remember. And you're absolutely right. You know, the relationships, I mean, Greg and I have certainly met, we've played in bands together and stuff, but DC and I still haven't never met in person.
Yeah.
I've never
seen his face in person. This is like the first time. Yeah. He's a lot older than I expected.
Oh God.
That's funny. But,
I am ancient.
No,
we all are.
But we've connected and done all this digitally, and certainly that's to come. But you know, the relationships really, really are everything, and it's so much fun to just be working day to day on a project with a concerted effort. And I do feel like when you were talking about, you know, the last couple of years of your grandfather's life, it's that kind of project that can continue to bring the energy and be the prompt to have some conversations that you probably would never have had, you know, quite frankly, if you weren't sort of in this concerted effort. So that's really nice that you got to spend a lot of that sort of intensive time together. It's quite a project and it's continued and you've continued to iterate. I mean, you mentioned Shark Tank. I'm a big fan. I've heard that, you know, they film for a considerable amount of time and then they cut that down. Did you find that there was a big difference in the experience versus, you know, what actually premiered on television?
Massive.
Okay.
Where do I start? initially, you know, everyone was telling me, oh, you should go on Shark Tank. You should go on Shark Tank.
Yeah.
And I have this pride about me where I don't want to do things the easy way. I don't want to borrow money from other people. I want to, I guess business 101 is you raise a bunch of capital, you ask all your friends and family to invest in you. And I was like, I don't want to do that.
I'm the same way.
And I know people who have done that and they have failed and sometimes over and over again. And then they go back to the well and they go back to their friends and family. And it's like, how do you do that?
How do you live with yourself? No, I know. Yeah, I agree.
If I'm going to fail, it's going to be all on me. And so I never bothered to apply, but it came at a time where I needed the money to kind of keep things going. And
well, there's a massive awareness boost, right?
Obviously, for sure.
That comes with that, right?
Yeah. And so
not bigger than being on this podcast, I will say, but you know,
this isn't the tipping point.
Of course.
Yeah. You've entered the lion's den.
Yeah. And so, the executive producer reached out to me
said,
you know, we're doing a holiday episode and how come you haven't applied?
I mean, there's no greater sign.
So I had to still apply and do all that. And I mean, and the process of applying and it just you know, I had to meet with my attorneys and, you know.
Oh, yeah.
It's,
well, you want to make sure your IP is all set before you go on and, you know, everything's just in a good place so that nobody gets any ideas and your patents are right.
But you have to understand that, like, some of the things, and I won't go into too much detail about the contracts and things, but I mean, everything is in the TV show's best interest and none of it is in your best interest.
Sure. Yeah, you got to be ready to make a deal, I assume, with a lot of due diligence done. And
totally. But and then, you know, my attorneys are like, I would never advise you to do any of this. You have to think about what business are they in. They're in the business of television.
Yeah.
And they're in the business of getting audiences and ratings. They're not in the business of stealing IP. And you'd be amazed at what people agree to. But thankfully, you know, the experience was fantastic. I don't have no regrets whatsoever. And you know, I practiced. I got life-size cardboard cutouts of each shark, and I put them in my basement and sat them in the chairs that they were, you know, going to be in. I figured out where my mark was going to be.
Yeah.
And practiced for hundreds of hours. And
I'm sure
I walk out onto the set, and they're in the wrong seats, and it destroyed me. And had I been more confident at the time, I would have been like, well, Mark, you need to switch with Barbara.
Get over there.
Preparing this way.
And now they sit in Eames chairs, right? I love that part.
Yeah.
They have those white Eames chairs.
So it was a great experience. I was on stage for over an hour, and they kind of chopped that up into, you know, whatever, 12 minutes or whatever it is. But I thought they were all very fair.
Sure.
Sometimes they take shots at people, but they my evaluation was, you know, wasn't outrageous. And I felt like I was relatively humble, and
they need that for the entertainment factor, I would imagine. Like they must coach some people to go in with a crazy valuation just so Mr. Wonderful can, you know, rip somebody apart.
I think people do that on their own.
Really?
There's no coaching.
Oh my God.
Yeah. The only coaching that I got was,
or maybe they don't tell them to change it. Ultimately, you know, you submit an application, you're trying to raise $100,000 for a $10 million valuation on something with no sales, you know. Maybe they're throw them into the shark tank.
Right. But that type of stuff, though, makes for great television.
Right, exactly.
You start crying. I mean,
right.
And thankfully I did. And it was honest. It was, started talking about my father or my grandfather, and all of a sudden it was like, oh, wow.
It's an emotional moment. Yeah.
Yeah, emotional moment. And it came across well, and it was, you know, natural. And
real. Yeah.
Yeah, it was neat. And then, I got to share the experience with my entire family, my nephews, my mom and dad, my brothers, and you know, who gets to do that?
Not on that stage, not a lot of folks, and come out with a deal. And Barbara, perfectly suited in real estate. I'm sure, you know, in the lobbies of all of her buildings, I'm sure she's got some modern Christmas trees at this point. How has that been, right? Has she helped you sort of evolve the product and you know, stayed in touch? How's that gone?
Thankfully, she sees this. I mean, this isn't, it's not a great Shark Tank product based on the price point. And,
do they want more of like a volume play versus being so niche, or is it just kind of?
Well, I think the sharks certainly want a volume play. The TV side of things, the TV side and the Shark Tank, they're two different. Yeah, they don't care about each other. They only care about the television. The sharks only care about, you know,
good
money.
Deals. Yeah.
Yeah. So, but she's not motivated that way. She knew that this was going to be what she called a slower burn.
Yeah.
But that this will be a company that's going to be around 20 years from now.
Yeah.
And that's not the case with a lot of, you know, these, I hate to say it, but, you know, tchotchke products where it's,
totally.
Right. Whoopee cushions or oversized sweatshirt, and good for those people as well, but they're going to make their $1 million or whatever. And, you know,
and that's it.
Have a company probably. And that's just the nature of their type of product. So she's, I feel no pressure from her ever. Mm. When I need a door open, I call her or I work with one of her kind of her right-hand man. But, you know, from you can understand that she's got dozens of companies, and her biggest company is herself. Right. And, and her public speaking. And so she's kind of given me creative control, and she offers input. I mean, the biggest advice that she gave me was, she's like, well, what's your best selling tree? And I said, the pearl white ring tree.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I said, it's 5 times more popular than any other tree. And she's like, well, get rid of all the other ones.
Yeah.
And I, you know, I in my, I'm thinking to myself, well, you know, these are my babies and this one, this one resonates with certain people and they all have a different look and feel. Right, and she's like, right. No, I don't, you know, I think you should get rid of all of them except that one tree.
Yeah. I mean, to get to the next level, it's, and look, it's an iconic product. It's a bit transcendent. And I do really feel like she recognizes that. I mean, I really, truly am an avid watcher. And when she equally sees just a flash product and says, I don't want in on it, but then she recognizes what could be iconic. And I would take a slow burn, a slow, sustainable, long-term investment that will continue to grow as, quite frankly, the audience for mid-century modern continues to grow and realizes that high quality products are going to last you a lifetime versus DC, going back to the point you made about, let's say, an LED tree, which could be $3,000. That's not going to last year over year for 30 years. That's not, you probably still have the same one that your grandfather made in the 60s. I mean,
I do.
You
know. Yeah, I do. Yeah. Yeah.
So it's still kicking. No, that's great. I'm glad she recognized it. And I do think she has a tendency to do that. It honestly, it's so cool to hear just firsthand. I've never really talked to anybody who's been on Shark Tank that, you know, she's got some involvement. She gives you some input. She also gives you some control. It sounds like what she's given you has been, you know, all the right direction. And hopefully that's paid off as it relates to the longevity of the product. Because I agree, if you can double down on the one that's working the best and share that to a greater audience at a higher price point with, frankly, no sales, because it's a product that doesn't need to be diminished in its price. Because you're going to have it for 30 years.
And that's been the tough thing from the beginning, is because my grandfather didn't have a lot of money. And so initially what I wanted to try and achieve was, how low can I get this price point? Because I really want that person who really wants it to be able to have it.
Yeah.
But we've kind of gone in the reverse, and, you know, we don't do anything now regarding like trying to cut costs or cut corners or is there a way to get that material cheaper? It's like, no, we want to have, and we've had, DC could probably attest to this at some level, because I don't know the experience that he had with his tree early on, but those were some of the, you know, first trees that we had, the first tulip stand that we had, the Eero Saarinen inspired tulip stand. It's a process, you know, you make something and you figure out the problems with it, and you hope that your customers will understand that this is a process, that we're not a huge company, that we're still learning and listening to their feedback, and how can we improve. And
I bet if somebody wanted to email you about the product, they could do that, and you probably get feedback all the time, right?
Absolutely.
That's a local store. Yeah. Right. That is the same. And I'm passionate about this stuff, because I would want to be that accessible as well. That is going around the corner to your local store and saying, hey, you know, milkshake wasn't so good, you know, back in the 50s.
Yeah,
what did you do differently? And how can you make it better? Right. You're open to that. And, you know, big companies, in my opinion, they're losing touch a little bit in that respect. You know, you got customer service, but you're not really thinking about it. You're just paying for it. And it's nothing like being able to have a conversation with somebody who's invested so much time and effort. All right, flash the tattoo. So much time and effort and blood, sweat, and tears. You know, in running the business and listening. Right, it's key.
I totally agree. And part of it was really trying to embrace doing things differently than anyone else. Yeah. So, you know, like, yeah, I mean, I pick up the phone. If the phone rings at 8 o'clock at night, I don't always pick it up, but sometimes it's in their shop that, you know, that I just saw you on Shark Tank and you pick up the phone.
Right, you know, right. Like, I bet.
I mean,
special.
And I think that goes back to this idea of, you know, your 1,000 true fans and not trying to be everything to everyone. You know, like, I heard people in the past, and I'm guilty of this as well, is like, how do we reach a larger market? Right? Yeah. How do we get this to resonate with a larger amount of people? And that's not what we're going for. We're the smallest viable marketplace, and this might not be for you. And that's okay.
I agree. And look, it is certainly valiant, going back to what you said about anybody who expresses interest or wants this, you'd love to be able to get them one. But that's what you do. You find the product that works, and then you made a half tree. You made a smaller one. Right. Yeah. And so you've made them more accessible in that respect. I think, you know, that is part of that constant evolution that I'm sure you've gone through, which is just, you know, it's all the right stuff, but it takes time.
Yeah.
It takes time.
A lot of mistakes.
The first time we worked together, Matthew, was I think 2015. Sounds we had right. the, when I was running the Facebook MCM group, and you put up a green 6-foot tree or 7-foot tree. I don't remember the size, but I remember it was green. And that caused such a flurry of activity in the group that people who had never made gingerbread in their life, gingerbread houses, were rather insistent. And so we got tons and tons of submissions because everybody was beside themselves at the thought of getting that tree.
Really? I did not know that.
Why don't you recap? So you started a contest, right, on this group.
I think I just found a photo of one of your trees, Matt. Just beautiful photo. I thought, why not? It's December. We'll put up a nice Christmas tree post. I think you contacted me. I can't recall how the details unfolded, but a contest was quickly became a contest. What kind of contest? It was gonna be a gingerbread, but a mid-century modern gingerbread house. And people, most of the comments I got at first were, is this a scam? Is this a real thing? Are you really giving away that tree? But by this point, Matt, a few posts that I had done previously, a lot of people loved the tree. So many people loved the tree. So when the contest was announced, well, the excitement was, as they say, palpable. And we got so many great submissions. And the person, funny thing is, the person who won, Diane, she got the tree. She was actually away. She lived in Toronto. And next thing you know, this rumor started circulating around within the group that, oh, yes, of course it went to a Canadian. DC is a Canadian, so you know. And she posted in the group, by the way, I'm from Texas. I was away in Texas when my tree was delivered. I don't care if it's January the 10th. I'm putting up my modern Christmas tree, which I think she left up for 3 months.
That's great.
She still puts it up every year. She loves it. I still get messages from her. And I'm surprised. I'm not surprised that the white one isn't the bestseller, or what did become the bestseller, because it is a beautiful thing. It's such an elegant looking tree. You did a pride tree, I believe, once.
Yep.
I think
that's
a rainbow tree. Do you still make that one? I'm just curious. Or is that
a lot of the stuff when I create something is, you know, trial and error. I did make some, but the minimum order was, you know, 150 of those trees. And so, I sell, you know, maybe a couple dozen a year, but it's not a big seller. But the cool thing about it, though, is certainly the LGBT community has been early adopters of the tree. And I partnered with the LGBT Center in Denver and the one in Palm Springs, and they auction them off each year as part of a fundraiser. Every year... this is really another cool thing about this whole business is that, you know, they put one up at this auction in Palm Springs and, you know, somebody paid $2,200 for it. You know, I sell them on my website, or I did at the time, for $1,000.
Yeah.
And in fact, they asked if I could donate another one because the person that came in second was willing to pay, you know, $10 less than the final.
Right. You're like, wait a second. We should try to.
And so it was, you know, I've done it here, and I've done it for, you know, charities throughout the U.S. And the tree is at some level a sign of inclusion, right? It's not like this isn't for you. I mean, it's for everyone. I mean, it's not a religious symbol.
No.
You know, I think that's one of the reasons why a lot of, you know, hotels and companies like the tree, because it's kind of non-denominational and all-inclusive. It's
well-designed. Yeah, all-inclusive. It does not bring the traditional religious...
Right.
The word I was going to say was baggage, but look and feel.
I think that's probably appropriate. Yeah.
You bring up a really good point, John, is that you will always have, of course, when you talk about Christmas and holidays and whatnot, there are those dyed-in-the-wool traditionalists who will always think that somehow 1870s Victorian England Christmas is what Christmas
is. It's Christmas, right? Right, exactly.
Yeah, it's got to be. Charles it's got to be Dickens exactly like thing, the yeah. old Charles Dickens type tree.
Yeah,
and, right. And if you stray from that, somehow it's not Christmas anymore for these people. You know, that's fine for them, but if you look at, it's funny because I'm not just a mid-century modern person, but my other passion is cars, and close behind that is history. I'm a huge fan of history. I was actually planning on becoming or studying history a long time ago, but that I didn't know what I would end up being other than a professor, and I was hardcore.
You found your intersections here. I mean,
the evolution of the Christmas tree is constant throughout the centuries. Whether you have the boughs on the mantle, the very first trees in quotes that came into the home. So if that somehow, even when you get to America and you got a post-war design, there were aluminum trees and there were very stylish artificial trees.
Yeah,
and then suddenly you get to the 60s, late 60s, 70s, and suddenly anything artificial was considered bad. I always think it's like, because I'm going to be a little glib about it, but it's like a hippie influence, I guess. You know, it's got to be more granola. It's got to be traditional.
Yeah, yeah. That makes sense.
Everything stalled there. As far as the evolution of Christmas, it hasn't changed at all. And suddenly, this quiet corner of America, you know, there's this guy who's continuing the traditions of his grandfather, who's made probably not being hyperbole. This is not hyperbole here.
Yeah.
The biggest design leap that I can think of in the design of a Christmas tree. It is. There's nothing, because even if you look at the other artificial trees of the 50s and 40s, they still pay homage to the branches. They still have branches. They still, in a way, they base it very much on the template of a real tree. Whereas you said, oh, no, 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 I'm going to be totally deconstructivist about it, or your grandfather did, I should say, and you
my grandfather.
And said, okay, what is, again, I always love the concept, and I've said it before on the podcast, is what is the maximum volume I can get with the least amount of mass? And modern Christmas tree is the perfect definition of that deconstructivist notion. And there's nothing, okay, go back. What is the most outrageous artificial tree as far as style and design goes prior to your tree, Matt? And you'd have to make a huge leap because you'd have to go back to the aluminum trees of the 50s and 60s.
Yeah.
And that's 50 years ago. So you restarted what was ongoing, but suddenly stalled. I know it is a bit, you know, we're talking, and again, I've used this word way too much, but it is an academic discussion talking about the evolution and history of Christmas and its traditions.
Absolutely.
But that's the key word is that it is an evolution. We have to progress. We evolve. Or, you know, this concept is evolve or die. I mean, that's a big statement for a tree, a Christmas tree, but
I like it.
But all aspects of life, I mean, if we, okay, we'll stop making new furniture circa 1975. So everybody who wanted to design furniture, stop. We've got all the furniture we need. We've just been recreating that. But that's what happened with trees. Like, here's your artificial Christmas tree. Everybody designing artificial Christmas trees, stop it. We're just going to keep making this one from now on. And we would not have it. We want choice. We want more of that. We want something new or different. And I got to tell you, when something comes along that is different, that you yourself could never have imagined, but still appreciate the genius of it, it's exciting. I don't know why you aren't mass producing these, because in my world, that was the only tree you'd ever want.
I agree with you, because then you know, you do the Walmart version, you license it, and then it's, I don't know, $200, and it doesn't, you know, it cheapens it a little bit.
John, you had a question for Matt about possibly licensing.
Yeah. Is that something you've considered in the past? You know, just going that route with any of those, you know, let's call it a bigger box retailer, somebody with distribution.
First of all, I really want to thank DC for saying that. And
and
you're right. Like why everything else evolves? Why not a Christmas tree? It actually doesn't really make a whole lot of sense. You know, you see the evolution of like technology and like, you know, things in the front yard and stuff like the inflatable this and the LED this and that. But it's like, if you have the choice between a real tree or an artificial tree,
a fake looking real tree.
and you can get it in pink if you want. But other than that, it's like there's nothing else. And then the other thing that you touched on is this idea of less is more, right? What is the minimal amount of material? And, you know, I don't want to get into an environmental conversation. I mean, that is one of the reasons why some people like it is like, you know, it collapses flat. They're concentric rings. talking about the minimal amount of material with the maximum pleasure and enjoyment and impact.
I mean, I look at A-frames in a similar way.
Yeah, exactly. You know, prefab.
You don't happen to know any of that catalyst or inspirational moment for your grandfather, do you, in this? You know, did something dawn on him and say, you know, he was playing with some cones outside and he stacked them up and said, you know what, I got an idea.
I wish his health was good enough at the time where I started to do this to be able to ask him, you know, those questions. I've asked all my uncles, you know, what do you think the reason was? And of course, the first thing they say is, well, because he's an engineer. Right. And that's the way his brain works.
Yeah.
And the time, you know, post-World War II, people made things, right? Yeah. It wasn't, I'm going to go buy this or I'll buy that. It's like, you know, my older brother got a workbench at age 4 that my grandfather made.
Wow.
You know, it's like he made things. And that's what people of that generation did. They made things. And then I had heard that somebody in the family had an allergy to real trees. And so,
Cool. Little function in there. Absolutely.
Form. Yeah. So less function. I think it was more function over form. I would bet that he stumbled onto this and was like, oh, wow. Okay. I might have something here. One of the things people ask about is this whole idea of the light and how the light interacts with the tree. And was that a purposeful?
Yeah. I'm curious about that.
Yeah. I don't think it was. There's one picture that I have of the tree. He was the cameraman in the family, so there's no pictures of him, of course. thousands of pictures of everyone else. But there's one picture where he's kind of down and looking up at the ceiling. But the trees, his trees were so busy, you know, pine cones and garlands and that, you know, it was about, and maybe it was just, this is a function of the time where it wasn't necessarily less is more, it's more is more.
Yeah.
Particularly maybe in the 70s, DC could probably speak more about that, but it wasn't minimalist. You know, it wasn't like, can we strip away components, the most critical components to this and allow them to shine and get rid of everything else. But there's only one photo of that. And for me, when I put that LED light underneath the tree and turned it on, I mean, it was just like, oh my, I mean, you know, it's not just this, it's all of this.
And
it was just like, how can I maximize that? You know, what type of that, you know, technology, you know, you people ask me, you know, what are you working on next? Or tell me about the evolution of the tree. And, you know, thankfully my grandfather was as bright as he was, because in terms of the architecture, the structure, the concentric rings, the acrylic or plexiglass rings, the ball chain that holds it together, that's all original.
I mean, I haven't made
anything. The only changes that I made is, you know, he had to manually cut these rings out of a piece of acrylic. So there was some sort of saw where you put something in the middle and then, you know, the saw goes around and then you'd have to do it for every ring. And then you have to manually drill every hole in that tree.
Yep.
And so now it's done with a CAD file and a laser machine, right? If you know anything about this, and
totally.
You know, you program it in, you know, you hit return and the thing starts plugging it out for you. And what we found out initially is there's absolutely no waste when you do it that way. There is, in fact, there's zero. And so you can't nest the tree together because you need a place for that chain to sit.
Yeah.
And so we had to actually redesign the tree with little dimples, I guess I'll call them, or recessions in the tree so that you could perfectly nest the tree, which you didn't have to worry about it because the saw created so much, you know, enough waste to where you would never have to worry about completely nesting the tree. So it's just little things like that were design changes, but that's just a function of technology and how these things can be made now.
Yeah, but look at that. And just reflecting on this conversation, right? We talked a bit about the history of a Christmas tree and how it's evolved and how it hasn't evolved. And now we're getting into the design details over time that this is the journey that you've been on to make this the best possible tree that it can be. And we're talking about a single item. And having an academic conversation about it, I mean, it's incredible. And it really, it's the type of conversation I want to be having, right? And digging into the way that you know, both fell and the conversations you had and everything that brought you here, brought you to Shark Tank and you know, that it's just, it's quite a journey. I am curious do you see that, you know, that, that respect for the process, that respect for the evolution in any other products, right, within our mid-century world here?
DC would probably have a better answer to this, but I don't think there's probably enough companies like mine that are doing this type of stuff this sure. way. You have the Herman Millers and the Modernicas and Knoll, and there aren't a whole lot. There were some that tried. There was another tree company that had kind of a, you know, mid-century modern design. And the problem, and it maybe has to more to do, less to do with design and more to do with being an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
It's like the majority of things fail after a few years. And people just are like, all right, well, okay, I'm going to go back to doing mortgages. And I mean, I think that's one of the reasons I got the tattoo on my arm. It's like,
reminder.
No, dude, you're going to do this and you're going to commit to this and, you know, go back to Seth Godin. You're going to pursue the smallest viable market and you're going to do that year after year after year after year.
Yeah.
And so there aren't a whole lot. There's an artist here in Colorado that I met that is doing kind of mid-century modern inspired art, you know, similar to Shag.
Shag's a great one to mention. Just like, you know, probably took time to hone in on the type of design and approach,
right.
You know, and then, and now has sort of this very particular style that, yeah. you know, you can then apply to all sorts of, you know,
I'm such a fan of his.
Yeah, that's a great one to mention. Maybe we thought Shag was a little too big, but, you know, great one to mention. Somebody who's just committed to the process and made it better and then
knows who his market is and knows who his market isn't. He's not trying to be more things to more people.
I
don't think he paints anything thinking, well, I hope this resonates with a larger market. I got to meet him in Palm Springs Modernism Week, and he wanted to have one of our trees in each of his galleries. So he's got one in Palm Springs and, you know, one in West Hollywood. That's like the perfect type of partnership. I think in marketing, there's a book called Brandscaping about partnering with those people who share an audience, but you don't compete with. He's the person who buys that $5,000 print. They're buying that because that represents their design aesthetic. That gives them a feeling. And I believe that my tree does that for people as well. It's not about that it's easy to put up, it's easy to take down, and it stores flat. You know, that's a feature, but that's not the reason why somebody buys the tree. They buy it because it's a reflection of their style and it gives them a certain feeling. And that's what I'm trying to do with the tree.
That's beautiful. And I think, look, I've seen some escutcheons. I think it's called Atomic Foundry. I think they're doing some cool stuff. You know, there's some birdhouses I've seen recently. Mm-hmm. You know, I would just say generally, I would encourage people who are interested in this niche to just go try to make something, right? And stay committed to it. Over time, those, you know, Minty's Breeze Block ice cubes they're going to be everywhere because we have those 1,000 fans, you know, within this community, and they're really passionate. They will go out of their way to build a gingerbread house, you know, and create something that's really special. We got a talented community here.
Yeah. I wanted to touch on the community. I always focus on, you know, the one fan, or not the one fan. They're not a fan. The one person that, you know, is super critical. But the reality is, and, you know, I think DC will can attest to this, when he would post, you know, images of the tree, you know, you get 2,000 likes and 4 people that had a bad day.
You develop a thick skin early on or you don't survive. And it's amazing too. People will post horrible things just to be horrible. Like, that's their day. Like, I'm going to say something. They will make the most outrageous accusations just because I got nothing better to do. Nobody loves me, apparently. But with the tree, there was a guy. Do you remember this, Matt, when a guy said that your grandfather had copied the tree?
Yes, I get that.
Come on.
Every now and again. And it's okay. There is a tree in a movie called Bell Book and Jar, I think it's called, that came out in the 40s. Mm. And it's concentric ring. I mean, here's the first thing is my grandfather didn't create the iPhone. This is a very simple design. I mean, that's in its beauty, how simple it is. It's a sheet of acrylic and it's concentric rings, and stick a light underneath it and see what happens.
Let's say your grandfather did see that movie. Let's say that planted a seed. Mm-hmm. Well, you know what? Great artists sometimes don't copy, but they certainly borrow. That's the same with design. You sometimes have to borrow. You borrow from the people that you're inspired by. You're borrowed by this fanciful notion, something you've seen. Yeah. I don't know why people seem to think that something inspired perhaps by something else is a copy rather than an homage or an evolution. I don't know. And those, you'll always get those comments.
That's such a good answer. And I go back to, it sounds as though you guys are music people.
Greg might be.
That's true.
Right. Give me one musician or artist that doesn't have any influences.
Absolutely. Yeah. I always think of this quote. I think it's John Waters who said, good artists borrow, great artists steal.
So, right. Yeah.
That was actually Picasso, by the way.
Oh, there you go.
Picasso? So,
and then John Waters probably said it and was like, it's mine now.
We're getting meta here. Yeah, I like it.
The theme song to this podcast, I mean, not that I stole it, but I lifted some lines from Mozart. Yeah. I mean, what's he going to do? Yeah. He's not going to find me. So.
My favorite thing about that quote about great artists stealing, one of my absolute favorite Banksy piece is not a painting or a mural. It's a slab of granite polished on one side, gravestone carved that quote with Pablo Picasso's name at the bottom. And he took a knife, scratched out Pablo Picasso's name, and scratched in his own Banksy.
Wow, I love that. I love DC's answer, but it made me curious to figure out, all right. Yeah, I mean, maybe he was influenced by that. And so I reached out to my uncle and my mom to figure out,
was that VHS tape lying around?
that's the funny thing is if you see the movie at the time, it must have been a very dark, dark movie. It's about black magic. It is a very dark. And I remember my grandfather was, Catholic church sang in the choir. Until
not a big voodoo guy.
Right. And the only way, there's two ways he could have seen it. He could have gone to the movie theater. And I talked to my uncle and he's like, we never went to a movie ever. A, there wasn't any time. And B, there was no money for things like that. And so I was curious about it. I love DC's answer. And the second thing is there's a chance he could have seen it in a rerun on a TV show or something. But if you look at his background, again, it's not a stretch that a guy that was an engineer that did projects for NASA and worked in engineering at aviation companies and built A-frame cabins throughout the Rocky Mountains, who flooded the backyard to make a skating rink for the kids to skate on.
Cool.
Who, built anything that he, needed, he tried to build, whether it was a desk for his grandchild, that's who he was. And again, I mean, and I don't even think that's even unique to him.
If your family member truly did have an aversion or allergy to a tree, there was a problem to solve. I agree that the copies are in the world right now, and especially in this design community, I do think that appropriately some folks are being called out for their copied, very blatant copied. I think I saw some. So Design Within Copy is a really good account. I don't know if you follow them at all, Matt or DC, Greg, if you guys have started following them. But they're calling people out. And when you blatantly take a Gio Ponti, painted and designed room and try to pass that off as your own, you should get called out. And we haven't really had that, previously. So I like seeing this trend, and I like the conversations it spawns. And then I love when they post that the person who ripped the other person off blocked them. Because there's nothing better than getting caught like that.
we've had to do that.
I'm sure there's been some copies of your stuff too. Yeah,
I would imagine. Have, and of course it's very personal when somebody does that, right? Like again, I go back you guys in music. It's like if somebody stole a song or a lyric, or not even a riff, but the whole song. How would that make you feel? It's like, and again, it goes back to, this isn't just me, it's my grandfather.
Yeah.
So, there's been some of that, but, the thick skin statement, I thankfully I've learned to have that. There's a famous, speech by, was it FDR called The Man in the Arena? the greatest speech ever. And it talks about the fact that it's the man in the arena that counts. It's not the people in the audience that point out where the man failed. Oh, and I think Brene Brown, the author, went on to say that if you're not in the arena, your opinion doesn't count.
Yeah, agreed.
Like, you don't count if you're not in the arena, because if you're in the arena, you understand, you know, the dust and the wounds and the pain that you have to go through.
Yeah,
right. Exactly. I think it's not FDR.
It's Teddy Roosevelt.
Teddy Roosevelt, thank you. Yeah, sure. Definitely worth checking out, though.
That's great.
Whenever I have a comment that is just so horrible, I remind myself, my dad sent that to me, and it's just like, you should listen to this. But anybody who's doing anything and putting themselves out there, you know, you have to have that thick skin or grow it, or, you know, listen to that speech over and over again.
Yeah, you get thicker skin, you throw some tattoos over it, and to remind yourself to keep going. Yeah, and exactly.
I have to say here, though, I actually read about your story long before we ever communicated on Facebook. And I am very, when growing up, I was very close to my maternal grandfather. He was a cabinet maker, and he taught me how to build, how to refinish
furniture.
Starts
early.
Yeah, and things that I do almost so regular now when I restore the stereos.
Yeah.
Every time I sand a piece of wood or I stain something, he is there. I'm not a spiritual person. I don't believe in things like that necessarily, but you know, there's an energy, I think, that surrounds you with that person somehow. And I think I feel them. My other grandfather was a boat builder, people who work with their hands.
Wow.
And when I saw that you were continuing a grandfather's tradition, this, for me, restoring stereos and furniture is as close as I get to continuing what was generations of carpenters and woodworkers in my family. We grew up in a fishing province. Nobody fished. We were one of the rare exceptions, but somebody had to build.
Wow. Yeah.
I'm not joking. It's almost 400 years of woodworkers on my mother's side. Because where I grew up, it was founded, it was first settled in 1583, founded in 1492, but first settled. And what was interesting about that is you continue that tradition. And I think that's what's nice about the tree. I think that's why I got behind you, is because it wasn't that I didn't love the design. I did. But you were connected to something that I consider so important to me. And that is that the traditions of our near ancestors, our grandfathers and our great grandfathers.
Yeah,
that's what gives me footing. Yeah, as far as when I feel something isn't quite right in life, I just think about hanging out and learning things from my grandparents. Because my grandmother also, you know, taught me how to make bread. So that's what it was for me, that this guy he deserves support. I want him to succeed so badly at this.
Yeah.
I appreciate you saying that.
And that's when I started sharing your images. I asked you shortly after reading your story, I think it was on your website, reading the story, and you had posted the photos. And there's a photo of what looks like your grandfather's wearing like a Heidi wig. Like a braided wig hat or something.
Do you know what that was? That was one of those things where you put the pot in it and you hang it from the from the ceiling. Oh, and he was a character, so he put it on his head. And
yeah, because he looks like he'd be fun to hang out with.
Yeah,
he was a blast. He had the greatest personality. He was so funny. He was just so great and such an amazing storyteller. Us grandchildren were just captivated by him. I mean, I remember, you know, my cousin, and she was probably 4 at a Christmas Eve, and she literally just followed him around like the entire night, like right behind him. You know, how can I get closer to you? So yeah, I appreciate you sharing those words with me, DC. Yeah,
and look, Matt, you've been a great storyteller. It's been so great to hear. It seems to even now more so make sense that your grandfather would have created something, you know, a focal point in a scene of family coming together, celebrating. And, you know, we certainly, I'd say, overwhelmingly recommend that everybody who's tuning in, you know, make one of these part of their homes, part of their scenes. Mm-hmm.
I'm thank you for that. It is such a unique centerpiece to the holidays.
Yeah.
And what it did for our family growing up is it made the holidays special and memorable. And now being able to share that with other families. You know, I got an email from a customer who lives in Palm Springs, and he sent me a photo of his tree. And he said, I want to thank you for carrying on your grandfather's tradition, because my wife loves this tree, and this will probably be her last Christmas. She was passing away with cancer. And, you know, it's like little things like that. It's like, okay, all right. I'm on to something here.
It's
resonating with people, and maybe it's not tens of millions, but it did for that person, and it did for her. And
it's better that way.
It does for other people too. So
it's better that way. So special. Cool. So great to hear that. And again, so great that you are accessible to that type of feedback as somebody who's truly living and bleeding, you know, your business and making those impressions on folks. So Matt, it's been so much fun. You know, really appreciate the time.
And, I thoroughly enjoyed this, guys. This has been the most enjoyable podcast I've been on, and I've been on a lot.
Second best show, only to Shark Tank. We'll take it.
I'll take that.
That's fine. All righty, Matt. Take care.
All right, take care, gentlemen. Thank you.
Thank you so much for tuning in and hearing this festive story of modern Christmas trees. We certainly recommend making this a centerpiece in your home and starting a new tradition, just like listening to this podcast. Tell your friends about these trees, our show, and we wish you a relaxing and enjoyable holiday season.